this morning as we worship the Lord. We'll see. Good morning. It's wonderful to have everybody here at Community Church, and we look forward to our picnic later today. If you can hear my voice, you're invited to the picnic. We'd love to have you. More information can probably be found in your bulletin or elsewhere, or you could even ask somebody around that looks like they know what they're doing and ask them, where's the picnic going to be? And they'll tell you. We have an exciting day today in our time of worship, but also our time of getting together at our picnic. We're going to have a baptism, and I'm excited for that. Matt, who's back there with the tech team, is going to get baptized, and we're very excited for that time. I want to let you know we've got a lot of things happening now that it is fall. There's many things rolling out, and you're just going to have to keep abreast to all the different activities that are happening here at the church. Let me just announce a few of them. One, we have three circles, and three circles is going to be an evangelism training tool that we're going to do on the 23rd. So on the 23rd, we're going to have an evangelism opportunity to learn how these three circles can be a tool to share the gospel of Jesus Christ. And so what I'm asking you to do is, this is the final day to sign up for that. Okay, if you have not signed up and you're interested in being part of that, please sign up in the narthex. There's a very obvious sign. You get to pick one of two things, taco salad or an Italian sub. Okay, we're getting those from Mancino's, and we'd be happy to oblige you with a free lunch, but you just need to sign up. So we need signups for that and for the books and for everything. So what are you going to do if you go out there and you're interested in three circles? You're going to sign up. Let's hear you all say that again. Sign up. Perfect. Okay. Not only that, but we are beginning our community small groups again, and we have many more opportunities for these community small groups. If you sign up for one of those, look, they're on Saturday, Tuesday, or Thursday. You can pick the location, the time. You got lots of choices. But sign up each individual person on the list, because we only have so much room to sign up. We want to keep them as small groups, so there's only 10 that are able to sign up for each group. Please take a moment to look at that as you're signing up today. Last thing, before we end the worship service today, and this is also for the praise team, before we end with a benediction today, we're going to learn of a wonderful opportunity for a missions trip for the teens of this church. So stay tuned. As soon as we sing that last song, go ahead and sit down once again as we get some information about the mission trip that's coming up. I just want to prep you for that so we're not all standing there awkwardly. Go ahead and sit down again. We'll hear about that, and then we'll receive a benediction. All right? You guys ready to worship the Lord?
Yeah.
Okay, all of those who are visitors, you're welcome here. We're so glad to have you, and we pray that the Lord blesses you. We are here to glorify God and enjoy Him forever by loving Him, by loving one another, and by loving our neighbors. Let's pray. Father in heaven, we come before you to worship you and adore you. The King of heaven, the Lord of lords, the King of kings, Jesus Christ, our Savior, we praise you, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, our one God, now and forever. We ask, Lord Jesus, that you would be glorified by our songs, that you would lift us up to knowing you and understanding that we can walk in your ways. And we pray, Holy Spirit, that you give us understanding this very day as you are present with us in the midst of this service, Lord. We thank you for being with us and blessing us by the truth of your word, and by the power of your Spirit ministering to us right now. We pray that you would bless us in Jesus' holy name. Amen.
Good morning, church.
Good morning.
I'm glad to be here. And I pray that you are too. Whether you're up or down, struggling through tribulations or whatever, if I had a show of hands, but don't, anyone who's not in a tribulation time or struggle, raise your hand. Don't look. Okay. And the songs that we're singing this morning, yesterday we were rehearsing them again at home. And I can't tell you, anymore. Just be engaged in the text and the tune, because we need every song we're going to hear this morning, and it prepares us for the Word of God to be broken to us. So let's stand together as we greet the Lord as one. Still, my soul, be still.
Good morning, Community Church. Morning. This morning our scripture reading is from Psalm 46. God is our refuge and strength, a very present help in trouble. Therefore, we will not fear though the earth gives way, though the mountains be moved into the heart of the sea, though its waters roar and foam, though the mountains tremble at its swelling. Selah. There is a river whose streams make glad the city of God, the holy habitation of the Most High. God is in the midst of her. She shall not be moved. God will help her when morning dawns. The nations rage. The kingdoms totter. He utters his voice. The earth melts. The Lord of hosts is with us. The God of Jacob is our fortress. Selah. Come, behold the works of the Lord, how he has brought desolations on the earth. He makes wars cease to the end of the earth. He breaks the bow and shatters the spear. He burns the chariots with fire. Be still and know that I am God. I will be exalted among the nations. I will be exalted in the earth. The Lord of hosts is with us. The God of Jacob is our fortress. Selah. Praise be to God for the reading of his word. Please pray with me. Father in heaven, we praise you and thank you for this very day you've given us. We thank you so much for your very presence here and now. And I pray your spirit move as we hear your word this morning. We come to worship you and you alone. Help us to be moved. May your word penetrate our hearts. May you help us to know that you are the one who forgives sin. You've sent your son, Lord. He paid a great cost for us. We praise you and thank you for that. Lord God, help us to focus this morning as we study and hear your word. We thank you for the many blessings that you've given each one of us. Thank you for the community that we get to serve in. Lord God, be with us this very day. We praise you and thank you in Christ's name. Amen.
We're singing a portion of Psalm 32, and you find the music in the Psalter, Psalm 32, letter B, if you want to follow the music there. Just so you know that we'll do this in a round. We'll sing through it once, and then this group here will start singing it. Just keep following, and I'll bring in the second group and sing with you. I think you'll be delighted to hear the harmony that the church can make together. So let's stand together as we declare what we believe and from Psalm 32. Come, what do we do? Sometimes it seems they never leave, if you noticed. And if you're down and out, this is the best place to be with the saints, because it gets discouraging as we walk this pilgrim journey by ourselves. And we're going to hear about the pilgrim journey in the Psalms of Ascent later on. So when trials come, be attentive to the text. Let it sink deep in our minds. I'm saying that for myself, maybe not for you, because I need this today when trials come. Thank you. Again, in the Psalter, I don't know the letter, but it's 126. I don't have that for me.
Yeah.
Page 830.
Yep.
Okay. And the tune is Wayfaring Stranger. And also, it's been asked the question, it's a good question, and I didn't answer it properly. Look at the second verse, third line, wherever that is on the screen. Let those who sow with tears and sighing, sing as they reap, and joy proclaim. May those who weep when seed is scattered gather their sheaves and praise your name. Pastor Jason, you're going to have to explain this. But the idea is that the people of God have been scattered everywhere, and he's calling them back home. The seed is, and you come home rejoicing. The remnant comes back. If you don't know it, we're remnants. My clothing is remnants, so it might as well be remnant spiritually. So if you know the tune and pick it up, it goes by rather rapidly, but it's a mournful song to rejoice later. Here we go.
Thank you.
to get on board? Have you memorized it yet? Children, all the children of God's family have a place in the choir. It's appropriate that we stand for get on board, little children. That includes all of us.
While they're coming up, I just so thankful for those of you who signed up for our Pray For Me campaign again this fall, and today is the official rollout of that. The packets for those of you who signed up are actually in the narthex right now, and it would be great if you would grab yours before you take off today. We will take them over to the picnic for those who didn't get it, but it would just be easier if you get it now. And we'll talk more about that later, but wow, all of a sudden, saw a lot of kids. Well, a lot of people anyway. So good to see you all. So we're talking about this map, aren't we? This has been what we're following through the catechism on, is looking at it as a map to show us the way to please God. Now, one of the things that we're also doing is reading these questions from the catechism. And even though the words sometimes don't make a lot of sense to kids, it's still really important that you get these in your mind, all right? And this one, especially today, is really important. So I'm going to ask the question, and we're going to all of us read it together and listen to what God has to say. So what is sin? All right, now there's lots of things we could talk about here, but sin is the most important thing for us to focus on right now. Sin means that we're not doing what we're supposed to do. Sin, that's calls it disobeying. You guys have heard that word before, haven't you? Disobey. That was one of the most important things when our kids were little, we had to just talk about all the time. We had this little phrase, obey right away. Do you know what that means, to obey right away? I didn't ask if you do it. I just asked if you know what it means to obey right away. You do, don't you? Most of you. It means that when your mom or your dad or a teacher or somebody says, I would like you to do something, that you do it. You don't just say, oh, I don't feel like it, or maybe later, and then you never remember. Obey right away. Sin means that we're not obeying right away, and it means, according to the catechism, that we're not conforming to God's law. Now, conforming, that's another hard word, but it just means staying on the rail. Now, remember, we've been talking about the train,
In fact, we even sing the gospel train, right? Get on board, little children. Get on board the gospel train. In order to get on board the gospel train, you need to know the map. You need to know what God is telling us to do. And God wants us to love him with all of our heart and with all of our mind and with all our strength. But let's think about what this might mean. Remember I said last week that, if we're all on the gospel train, what's the train supposed to do? Stay on the tracks, really. That's exactly right. The train is supposed to stay on the tracks. And when the train stays on the tracks, then everybody gets to their destination safely. But what happens if the train doesn't stay on the track? What would happen? Well, for one thing, in our map, if the train went off the track, it might end up in the water, right? It could end up in trouble, and we'll see that even next time when we talk about what happens when the bridge is out, all right? But sin is like getting off the track. The track in our little map just reminds us of God's plan, God's purpose that he has laid out for us in his word, the Bible. That's what God wants from us, is to obey him all the time. Obey him right away. And when we do, he will protect us and keep us safe. All right, let's stand together and pray. Father, I thank you for your word. Lord, you've told us everything we need, according to Scripture, for life and for godliness. And that means that there's a lot of things we don't know. There's a lot of decisions we have to pray about, and we have to ask wisdom from others. But Lord, you've laid out for us all that we absolutely have to know in order to please you. I pray that you would instill in all of our hearts and minds the importance of obedience to you, because it isn't just kids that need to obey. All of us adults need to obey you as well, every moment of every day. Thank you for hearing us. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Let's take a moment together and let's pray. And as we pray, I just want to just personally thank you all for your prayers for my dear wife as she had her gallbladder out this week. Thank you for just praying for us and encouraging us with notes. And what a pleasure it is to be part of the body together. Let's pray together. Father, we rejoice in the goodness of you and your hand that has given us your Son, Jesus Christ. No greater love could we ever receive than to know that he came for us, that he climbed down into the miry pit in which we were sunk in our sin from birth, and even as we have brought forth sin in our lives by seeking ourselves and our idols and anything that is not of you, Lord. For in our flesh, we desire anything that is not answering to the God who made us. But Lord, in your graciousness and in your time, you revealed to each and every one of your people the truth of the Lord Jesus Christ. And thank you, Lord God, for that gift of faith that we can believe and hope and trust in him. And this morning, Lord, as we believe and we hope and we trust in the work, the perfect work of Jesus Christ upon the cross, paying for our sins, dying for us, and rising again and promising us new life, that in you, Lord God, we are complete and we are made whole. And all of that brokenness is taken care of by you, by your Spirit working within us, comforting us, encouraging us, counseling us, being our advocate, oh God, we thank you. What a wonderful God we serve, that he would not abandon us or leave us, but has instead surrounded us and is with us now. Lord Jesus, we need you as we pray to you this morning for many people who are hurting, who are going through physical issues. Lord Jesus, whether it's surgeries or whether it's hearing a diagnosis or whether it's going in and finding out that now there's new complications or new issues, Lord, we lift up to you beloved members of our church, and we have so many. Our hearts are filled with them, Lord, but we consider Dick Ziegler, and we think of him, and we pray for Bonnie Humphrey today, Lord Jesus. We lift them up to you. We ask your blessing upon them. Bill Moore, and we pray for him as well and for his health. Father, we pray for Celia as she is at home as well. And we ask, Lord Jesus, that you be with all of those who are not able to join us and be with us this very day. We thank you, Lord God, for your hand of not only healing, but your hand of provision as you walk with us through the trials of our life. You do not leave us as orphans, and we thank you for that. Lord, we thank you that when we come together, we can praise you as one voice, and we can also participate in the ministry of this church with our time, our talent, and our treasures. And so, Lord God, we pray your blessing now on the giving of our treasures. We give to you that which you have given to us abundantly, and you ask only a fraction, Lord. So we give back to you this portion and say, Lord God, use it for the purposes of the ministry of your church. Here in this place, Lord, may we use it effectively and purposefully to reach the lost and to equip the saints to follow you and to proclaim your name. Lord Jesus, we pray blessings and we thank you for all of those who serve in the gospel ministry. And we pray, Lord Jesus, that even today, as we lift up those who serve with us in many ways, we lift up those like Dave and Deb Walker, who have lived and served in Singapore for so many different years, creating an equipping ministry for many different pastors and leaders and teachers all throughout Eastern Asia. And we pray for them, Father, especially as they make a transition back to the States, but continue their work. And so, Lord, we're going to need to pray for them even more as now they have to travel even farther to accomplish that work, as they have to make telecommunications, as they have to make all of these plans from such a distance. But they're doing so with purpose and with hope and with joy. And so, Lord God, we pray for a strengthening of their lives in ministry and also our partnership together with them. Help them, Lord. Bless them. And thank you so much that we can participate in their loving ministry of the gospel of Jesus Christ. Bless us and prepare us now, Lord, as we come to your word. As we study it together, would you give us insight from the wisdom of the Holy Spirit? And may your words and not mine be heard in the hearts of each and every person here. We thank you, Lord Jesus, for giving us your very self, your word. And Lord, we pray now that as we learn and as we grow, that we would be more and more like your Son, Jesus Christ. In his precious name we all pray. Amen. Amen. Well, we're doing a study on the Psalms of Ascent. These are Psalms 120 to 134, and these psalms give us an understanding of traveling up as the pilgrims would do in that day. The people of Israel would travel up the mountainsides from the valleys, from far away, to go up and worship in Jerusalem. Jerusalem, the place where the holy temple of God was. Where it's told, according to Scripture, it is God's footstool upon the earth. So we can imagine him enthroned, crowned on high, and on upon his throne as his feet rest upon the earth. Now we know that this is just a depiction. For God is everywhere, and he is infinite, and nothing can contain him. Not even heaven can contain the glory and the power of the presence of the Lord. And so this illustration also shows the holiness of this city, and that people would travel from far and wide to be in the presence of God, to be in that place where they could bring their sacrifices and be forgiven for sins and have this place of relationship. But I want you to notice this. Jerusalem itself on the earth And all of the ideas of sacrifice and these festivals were all shadows of one who is coming. And the one who is coming is Jesus Christ, the Son of God. And all of these things, Jerusalem, the worship of him, the sacrifices, will all be taken care of in Jesus Christ. He fulfills the law. And he has promised us, as we know in Revelation, a new Jerusalem, where he will dwell with us and be the very light. We won't need a sun or a moon. We'll just need him with us forever. And this is exciting. This is our pilgrim journey. As much as the pilgrims were journeying on to Jerusalem to worship God and to praise him and to be in his presence, so too, O Christian, are we in a pilgrimage throughout this life. And as we've noticed and we've read some of these scriptures, it is a journey. There are trials. There are tribulations. There are moments where we look up and we see nothing but mountains ahead of us. And we don't know what the travails and the trials of life will be. But then we're also told to look up even higher, to lift up our eyes. In 123, lift up our eyes to the one who's enthroned. Don't keep your eyes just on the hills. Look to the one who made the heavens and the earth. That is where our focus needs to be. That is where our hearts need to be. So this morning, as we look at Psalm 125 and 126, would you turn with me in your Bibles this morning? As we consider our pilgrim journey in light of those who are journeying on to Jerusalem, and we see in many ways their reflection as they travel through this. We are these pilgrims, and the journey of life ahead of us is to our eternal home with the Lord. But God has chosen us and has formed us for this journey. He's actually formed us for the journey ahead, and he's done this, and he's made us his people, God's people. And so what we are looking at in 125 and 126 is a contemplation. If you can imagine, as you're walking and you're thinking of how hard the road is, but then you begin to realize how great God is, you begin to then focus on who he is. And what that brings is, who am I in reflection to who you are? And so what I want us to contemplate today is, who are we, O Lord? Who have you formed us to be? By our past and by our present, who are you forming us to be? So this morning as we look, let's consider these things. But first, let's hear the reading of God's word. Would you stand with me, please? To honor the Lord in his word as we hear it proclaimed. Psalm 125 and 126. Those who trust in the Lord are like Mount Zion, which cannot be moved, but abides forever. As the mountains surround Jerusalem, so the Lord surrounds his people. From this time forth and forevermore, for the scepter of wickedness shall not rest on the land allotted to the righteous, lest the righteous stretch out their hand and to do wrong. Do good, O Lord, to those who are good, and to those who are upright in their hearts. But those who turn aside to their crooked ways, the Lord will lead away with evildoers. Peace be upon Israel. When the Lord restored the fortunes of Zion, we were like those who dream, when our mouth was filled with laughter and our tongue with shouts of joy. Then they said among the nations, the Lord has done great things for them. The Lord has done great things for us. We are glad. Restore our fortunes, O Lord, like the streams in the Negev. Those who sow in tears shall reap with shouts of joy. He who goes out weeping bears the seed for sowing shall come home with shouts of joy, bringing his sheaves in with him. Praise the Lord for the reading of his word. Amen. You may be seated. We're going to read phrases like Israel and Jerusalem and Mount Zion. And what I want us to understand is that when he talks about Mount Zion, that is typically a phrasing for the mountain in which Jerusalem sits. So whenever you talk about Mount Zion, you're talking about Jerusalem itself. When you talk about Israel, you're talking about those who are the people of God. Now, I want us to not just think of that as in Old Testament terms of the Jewish people of the Hebrews. I want us to think of this in the wrestle that Jacob had with God. Remember, his name was Jacob, which means deceiver. Yeah, nice name. One who clutches, because he was clutching onto his brother's heel as he was born. But in that night, that wrestling with God, something changed. God gave him a new name. And that new name is, and you guys are going to love this, the one who fights with me. That's the name that God gave to his people. The one who fights with me. How do you like that? It's what's interesting is, doesn't that feel like that's us at times? We have this relationship with God that we're kind of like fighting with him at times. We're kind of a squirrely young toddler that doesn't want to settle down. And the Lord is the one bringing us to that place of peace. Jesus in John 15 said, "I am the true vine. You are the branches. I am the vine." As we look in the Old Testament, so many times that vineyard motif or that vine motif was used to depict Israel and their relationship with God. God was the vine dresser, and Israel was the vine. But Jesus in John 15 says, "I am the true vine," meaning I am the true Israel. And all of you are what? You're connected to me. I am in you, and you are in me, in John 15. Apart from me, you can do what? Nothing. But in him, all things are possible. So I draw this to an understanding that when I'm talking about Israel, though the psalmist is thinking of the nation and the people of the covenant, I am thinking of all of those who are part in Christ, the covenant of God's grace. If you are a believer in the Lord Jesus Christ, you are part of Israel. You are grafted in to the promises and the covenant that was to come, and it was all fulfilled in Jesus. I bring that up because this morning, as we look at this journey, we're going to see some things that are going to encourage us based on the topography and the geography and the reality of Jerusalem, but it's going to reflect to us in our lives as well. So let's look at this first. Our past, this is how God has formed us, starting with our past. Those who trust in the Lord are like Mount Zion, which cannot be moved but abides forever. As the mountains surround Jerusalem, so the Lord surrounds his people from this time forth and forevermore. Amen. I just wanted to bring up some geography so you understand this. Like, this is an actual depiction here. We have this area right here, which would typically be part of Mount Zion, and this would be the peak. This is the city of David, where the old city of Jerusalem was, now going up into this other old section of Jerusalem. All of this is Jerusalem, by the way, but you can see it is surrounded by what? Mountains, higher peaks than Mount Zion. Mount Zion is this high area where they have the city sitting, but around it are even still slightly higher mountains. Now, we'd look at that, some would say, well, those just kind of look like hills. But believe it or not, they're actually individual mountains. And notice how he's saying that the Lord surrounds, the Lord is like the mountains that surround Jerusalem, that holy, wonderful place that we're going to, that idea of the pilgrim, where we're going, God has surrounded like the mountains. Here's the idea in the Old Testament. What can move those mountains? Nothing. They are forever. They are enduring. And that's what the psalmist is depicting. There's an enduringness to these mountains that surround and protect Jerusalem that will not go away. Do you understand that in your life there is a promise from God that if you are in his son, Jesus Christ, you are surrounded by his grace permanently, forever? That means now. But when we're talking about our past, we have to think about in the past, God has protected us, hasn't he? He's watched over us. He's seen us to this very day. He's seen us to a place of salvation in our lives. How many people can think of so many different ways that they should have died before they came to Christ? Go ahead and raise your hand. Yeah, thank you. I want you guys to notice that. I'm not alone. 20 years old, on my 20th birthday, guess who ran a red light? I still have my hand up, right? And T-bone, right in the side. I watched as glass flew off. It's almost like in slow motion in my head, glass flying off my forehead as I smashed the window, and my whole door was smashed in, and the chair was moved to the side. And I can still to this day hear that impact sound. If anybody's been in an accident like that, you can still have that a moment. And I remember right at that moment, by the way, I was on my way to a Bible study. And so I felt okay, and the policeman said, this is the only thing I found in your car that was worth something. It was my Bible. I'm like, you're right. I'm like, that was worth something to me. But just to go to show, you might be on your way to a youth group function or a Bible study and still break the law and still have to face consequences and still might lose your life. My mom on my 20th birthday has to get a phone call from the highway patrol saying, ma'am, stay calm. Your son was in an accident. We go through these moments, don't we? But look at how God has surrounded you, has kept you for the moment of salvation. He will not let you fall. You are part of Israel. You are part of his covenant people. He's not going to let you down. In fact, Colossians, Paul was speaking to the Colossians and saw this, and I'm looking for where the scripture is that I have here. Hold on, I got to follow my notes. You know, I leave my notes behind so often. Colossians 3 reminds us that we are hidden in Christ. We're hidden in God with Christ. This is like the surrounding of the mountains, but Paul sees it in this different way, that we are inside God and hidden with him in there, with Christ. And I thought, what's a good example of this, especially one that's going to give us some assurity and some security and a sense of having mountains around us, because we're kind of, we got to go all the way up to the UP to find mountains, right? So how can we get this? Well, I thought, you know, here's a good example. A noble, powerful bald eagle. Who's going to mess with a bald eagle, right? We're the little chick. We're hidden in this nest with a much stronger, much more powerful, and much more dominant King of the air. We have the Lord Jesus Christ. We're like this little chick. We're in there, hidden in God with Christ Jesus. What greater place do we ever have in the entire universe than to be positionally there with God right now? And this is something that God has already done for us. Brothers and sisters, we're already there. We're just wandering in our pilgrimage to catch up to that reality. And as we do so, let's find some encouragement by this. What can the life do to me when the Lord has surrounded me, when the Lord has protected me? I am so secure in Christ that I am set there forever. I'm unlike those, and he starts to say this in verse 3, I'm unlike those who are the wicked. He says, for the scepter of wickedness shall not rest on the land allotted to the righteous, lest the righteous stretch out their hand to do wrong. Now, many times God brought other countries and nations to deal with Israel and brought a scepter. And he brought this to discipline them and to have that, to show them that they're not doing right and to have them turn back to God. We see this in the book of Judges over and over again. It's like a cycle, and it keeps going on and on and on. People repent and turn to the Lord. He saves them. Then they start to stray. Then he brings a nation, and they discipline them, and the people repent, and it goes in this circle. And we see this also with the kings in many ways as well. We have good kings and we have bad kings. We have those who serve God and we have those who turn from God. And God brings continually nations against them, wicked nations. Assyria, Babylon, the Philistines, those who worship other gods. The Lord in his divine providence will use those to discipline his people. But what is the promise? In this way, it seems like that wickedness will never last over Jerusalem. It'll never stay there because God will move it along. And why will he move it along? He moves it along not just because of those who are likely to reject God, but he moves it along because what happens when bad company begins to corrupt good morals? We start to do what as the people of God? We start to reach out for that as well. It happened in the journey of Israel through the wilderness. Time and time again, they were tempted by the other nations and they wanted to be like the other nations. And finally they said, give us a king like everybody else. And so what did God do? He said, okay, I'll give you a king like everybody else. In fact, the one that is chosen to be a king, he's a foot taller than everybody. His name's King Saul. And he's a foot taller and he's this big strapping guy. And everybody's like, yes, that's a king like all the other nations. How did Saul do? Not good. Not good, because what did he begin to do? As all those other nations were around, he began to grasp for those things that were not of the Lord. But there was a young man up in the hills watching over sheep. And what did God do? He plucked this little man from obscurity and made this little shepherd boy into a young man who would be a man that would follow after his own heart. Now, we all know the story, right? He followed the Lord. He followed after his own heart. He prepared the building of the temple of God. But what was something that this man did? He reached out and he was tempted by wickedness. See, this is a pattern that happens in the lives of believers. It's happened ever since the beginning. We go through these trials and tribulations, but why is it that David is still called a man after God's own heart? Because he did what? He repented. He turned back to the Lord and he said, I've sinned against you and against you alone. And he faced the consequences of his sin. He faced that it was going to cost him his own family and that he was a man now of blood, murder. He was a murderer. And he was not going to be the one who was going to build the temple that was going to be a temple of peace. That was for his son. All of this ties in for us to understand that those influences in the world, that God is actually working to get them out of our lives in many ways. And this might mean that we have to go through times of temptation, times of struggle, times of repentance and asking for forgiveness. But guess what God is doing in our lives? He's sanctifying us. The Holy Spirit is not done doing his work in us. He is making it so that we are not like those who reject God. We are like those who embrace him. We are like those who follow him. It doesn't mean that you're self-righteous or that there's something extra special in you. It means that the Holy Spirit is working to humble you to rely upon him every single day. Just as Israel, as those who are traveling, were looking and going, oh, Lord, we could be like the other nations if you let that be so near to us that we would start to desire it. One thing that we've been talking about is when that desire starts to enter into the church. When society and the standards of society begin to become the standards within the church itself, then guess what we've already done? We've already reached, we've already grasped, and we've already brought wickedness within the church. Well, he's not done here. For those of us who are in Christ, for those of us who are surrounded by the mountains of God, who is protecting us now and forevermore, look at verse 4. We have a cry. We can cry out to the Lord, and we cry out to him for peace. We say, do good, O Lord, to those who are good and those who are upright in their hearts. But those who turn aside to their crooked ways, the Lord will lead them away with evildoers. Peace be upon Israel. We can call out and we can ask for peace to be upon us. We can ask for the Lord to bless us. Notice he's not saying, the pilgrim is not saying, peace be upon Jerusalem. What is God saying? Peace be upon the people of God. Peace be upon us. That shalom. That shalom that means I am at peace with you and you are at peace with me. And I am at peace with God and I'm at peace in my soul. Peace be upon the people of Israel. But notice what his first cry is. Do good. He's saying, please, Lord. There's a plead here. And it's in the form of a command. But do we ever command God? No. This is what we would call in Greek or Hebrew an entreatment. Somebody who's entreating, please, Lord, here's my desire that you do good to me. Now, here's a bold statement. Do good, O Lord, to those who are good. Ho, ho, ho. Hey, guys feeling a little good now? I have a hard time with this scripture. Why? Because I don't feel good. I don't think I'm good. How in the world, O Lord, can I be good? But Spurgeon wrote this just one little phrase as I was studying this, and it's one little phrase that just caught my eye. He said, faith is the root of righteousness. Remember Abraham? When he was still a pagan worshiping the moon and he was all up in Ur, and God called to him and said, come to a land that you and your descendants will inherit. And I will make them like the sands of the sea. And it says in scripture that Abraham believed God and it was what? Credited to him as righteousness. Because he trusted the Lord. He trusted the word of God and what God had to say. And God declared him righteous or good. Brothers and sisters, if you are in Christ and you have faith in him, you are good in the eyes of God. Let that settle in because I don't think it settles in enough. You are good in the eyes of God. That doesn't mean that you're perfect and you're not without sin, but Christ has done what for you in your sin? He has paid the penalty. The problem is, I think so often, we don't believe it's paid. We don't trust that his payment was complete and satisfactory. Lord, you don't know how bad of a sinner I am. Look who you're talking to. This is the King of righteousness, who cannot have sin be anywhere near him. It does not exist around him. It is like bringing, as fall comes and you'll see people burning, it's like bringing all of the dry leaves to the fire. What's going to happen to the dry leaves? The same is true with our wickedness before a holy and righteous God if we don't have somebody already paying for it. But he did. And because of that, God can declare us good. And especially in our hearts, because we trust the Lord. That's the key, is that we have trust and faith in him and what he has done. We're looking to him and to him alone and not to our own hands. And we trust in him, and he will keep us and he will hold us. And this, brothers and sisters, should give us a moment to be able to feel the rest that we have in this pilgrim's progress. There is a rest to be had in Christ where we can cry out to him, Lord, do good to us who are yours, who are good. To those who are upright in heart, we desire the things of God. We look at his law and we say, amen, that's good. I want that, Lord. I can't quite do it on my own, but I want it. And I see that it's good, and I affirm that it's good. Lord, help me. And we start to realize that there's a duality to us in our person, not by what God sees, but in us. We are sinners, yet saints. We're both together. But Christ has declared to us that we are forgiven. So what do we do with that forgiveness? This is just a side thought. All of a sudden, I'm thinking of this. What do we do with that forgiveness? We often go out and sin more, right? So we can come back and wipe our feet on the foot on the welcome mat of forgiveness. Oh, thank you, Lord, for forgiving me. Ah, that sin was so much fun, but oh, please forgive me. Here I am wiping off my feet again. Do you understand how belittling? Imagine instead of a format that says grace on it, imagine it's the cross. Do we continue to go back and bring more that he had to pay for? He's paid for it all. Why do we continue in sin? Let the Lord change your heart and move you from that sin to the righteousness that he already declares upon you. Let the Spirit work in your life and seek that way. Whatever that sin is, confess it, share it with another, find ways to get away from it. Faith is the root of righteousness. Do you trust that the Lord Jesus Christ has bound you to himself? Look at what happens if we combine verse 1 and verse 5. Let me just try this. Those who trust in the Lord are like Mount Zion, which cannot be moved and abides forever. But those who turn aside to their crooked ways, the Lord will lead away with evildoers. Notice the contrast here. Do you trust in the Lord and turn to him, or do you turn aside and start following the way of the rest of the world and think that's a better way? Or maybe in the end, I can wipe my feet clean right before I die, and God's going to forgive me. Let me remind you, no one knows the day or the time that the Lord will take them home, and they will face judgment. No one knows. Don't assume on tomorrow. Today is the day of the Lord. Seek him while he may be found. And you'll see that as they're contemplating, as they're walking through this pilgrimage, as we're walking through this pilgrimage, the one thing that we need in this trial is the peace that only comes from Christ. So call out to the Lord and say, Lord, may your shalom be upon me. May I be at peace with you, meaning I'm not walking away from you, I'm walking towards you. May I desire to walk in your ways in my life and not my ways. And we'll see that the Lord has already given us and granted that peace in Jesus Christ. He is our peace. In fact, what did Jesus say to his disciples? Peace I give you, peace I leave with you, not as the world gives, but I give you my peace. Brothers and sisters, are we walking in that peace? Are we trusting in the Lord in that peace? Well, okay, let's go on because they're still ascending. Psalm 126. We see now the present of what we're going through. We see what God has done. We see what Christ has done. And now it's like we're coming out of a fog. It says, when the Lord restored the fortunes of Zion, we were like those who dream. To imagine that the King of heaven, the King of righteousness and glory, has forgiven us of our sins and set us free. Do you feel like you're walking in a dream? If you remember what you were like before, maybe you grew up in the church like me, and you go, okay, well, I don't remember what my life was like, compare, contrast of me as a Christian, but I can tell you one thing I know is that if Christ had not taken me as a child, I would be the absolute worst of sinners in every single way. Because all I want to do in my flesh is serve myself. And I don't want to serve him. And he knew that about me. He knew he had to pick me out of the fire early or I was going to be burnt to a crisp young. And so this is what the Lord is doing. In this present, he has formed us. By his saving grace, he has formed us. And that's why we're realizing that we're restored. We're restored. Maybe it might not be the fortunes like the idea of riches and glory and camels and all those kind of things that they probably look forward to then. And it's not looking at the TVs or the cars or societal norms of what success is today. But he says when he restores our fortune, what is he restored? How about us from the dead to life? How about us from children of wrath to children of Christ? How about us from enemies of God to co-heirs with Jesus Christ upon the throne of heaven? You're walking like you're in a dream? Why would I ever deserve that? Lord, I'm kind of staggering through this wonder of your grace. It abounds to me. Do you feel that? Do you understand that? I pray that this morning you'd be more and more equipped by that truth. That the peace of God rests on you is no small thing, for the rest of the world deserves his wrath. Wrath or peace, which one do you want? I'll walk with the peace, please, please, Lord. I don't deserve it. I certainly don't, but you have given me joy. You've given me joy. Look at what it says. Then our mouth was filled with laughter and our tongue with shouts of joy. We realized how much we had been saved, how much had been restored, and how much we had lost. Then they said, among the nations, the Lord has done great things for them. So I put up this little guy looking with his microscope because the joy that we have in Christ is visible to the world and is a proclamation of the Lord. And look at what is promised here. Those who are far off from God, the nations, the Gentiles, those who don't know Yahweh, those who do not know Jesus Christ, those who do not know the power of the Spirit and the joy of his presence will look and be able to proclaim, okay, God's the one that's doing this. Because this doesn't come naturally. There's nothing in the world that can provide this kind of hope, this kind of joy in the midst of your trials, in the midst of your sorrows, in the midst of a journey like you've had. I had one of the dearest ladies in the Lord dear friend of Sandra and I, a homeschooling family. We would do these reading and writing things that Sandra would do for the kids, and we would have entire get-togethers where the kids would read their poems or read their stories, and we'd all listen. We'd have like a banquet together, and this sister in the Lord, she was dying of a brain tumor, and she had 4 kids. And she was training them up. She was encouraging them and teaching them. And she had a loving husband. I have never seen anybody with so much joy, with so many things to lose. She had young kids. She had teenagers. She had a young lady who was about to go off into beyond high school. All the way down to one who was just elementary age, a friend of my daughter that's 6 years old. But she was so joyful in the Lord, even as she was dying. She wouldn't hear of anything negative. She's like, no, the Lord is good. And she would rejoice in him. Yes, she would lament over not being able to see her children get married or graduate or anything like that. But she had such hope in Christ and where she was going and who held her fast that it had to be a testimony to the rest of the world. It was a testimony to me as a believer because I'm looking at her going, sister, I don't know if I'd have that kind of strength. But she did because it came from Christ. And it was a proclamation to the rest of the world, so look at what the Lord has done. Verse 4. Restore our fortunes, O Lord. Now this is present time. The things that are going on presently in our lives, Lord. Restore our fortunes, O Lord, like streams in the Negev. You have to understand the Negev is the wilderness, that wandering area. It's dry, it's desolate, and there's only moments in which there is rain that will flow. And suddenly, those places that look like craggy valleys become filled up with water. And they bring life to the desert, and they bring a renewing spirit to that whole land. I love this. This is in the desert in India. And suddenly there was a flash flood, and guess what came of it? All of these seedlings started popping up with these beautiful, beautiful flowers decorating that whole area. Those who sow in tears shall reap with shouts of joy. The challenge was laid down by our worship leader this morning. Pastor, you're going to have to explain that. I explain it in one way. Jesus Christ, for the joy set before him, endured the cross and scorned its shame, that he would then ascend to the right hand of the Father, and by so doing, bring many captives in his train. Bring all of us who are the slaves now of righteousness of Christ to follow him and to be with him. He walked the way of suffering because it had a purpose. And the Lord lays out, even in our lives, a purpose to our labor. Notice what he says. They go out weeping, and they go out with a purpose. What are they going out to do? Sow seeds. With sorrow, they're going out to sow seeds, and they're weeping. This is toil. This is labor. This is hard work. But only the Lord can turn around that weeping to a place of joy. Only the Lord can bring us to a new place of understanding. And what we thought was labor in vain turns into a wealth of righteousness and joy as we see God working in our lives, changing our hearts, changing the hearts of those who didn't believe and then suddenly believe. In my heart, I've got to tell you guys, maybe I've shared this with you before. My previous church, I had a gentleman, his name was Al. And Al was 80-something years old, and Al, for 23 years, had been a Catholic monk and had devoted himself to Catholic monking and whatever he did there. He said, you could never have told me anything about God because I knew everything about God. He said, when I was a Catholic monk, I knew it. You didn't have to tell me it. And then Jesus saved me. And one time I'll have to tell you, his conversion to Christ, it came from the little hand of a four-year-old reaching out in a time of prayer over pizza. And suddenly he said, I saw the face of Jesus. And I realized that I needed to give up and realize I didn't know anything about Christ, because he really wanted to know me, and I didn't feel I was worthy to be known. But he called to me, and he calls to you. And this gentleman, now in his 80s, said, Lord, I've got to make up. Pastor, I've got to make up for the time that I've lost not serving him. So he went faithfully. I mean, we're talking like thick winters, everything. Al goes faithfully to a senior center, and he gives them a half-hour service every week, sometimes singing in his own voice. He's like, I'm very sorry that I have to do that. And then he gives them a 15-minute sermon. And almost inevitably, every single sermon was pretty much the same sermon. He had different subjects, but it was always come to the Lord. Come now, before it's too late. And people accepted Christ. And people came in those moments. Al, through his tears of the things that he had lost and the direction that he had gone in his life, was now seeing a reaping of benefit from the Lord and joy in this, and died joyfully in Christ and is with him now eternally. And that truly is our eternal reward. When we finally get to that place of Jerusalem of heaven, that place of God's presence and God's kingdom, we will see that every single tear had a purpose in God's plan to bring us to the place of salvation and to share that with others. And that he would not let just like he did not let a single drop of Christ's blood fall to the ground with it being wasted. It purposed itself in saving for sure every person who would be saved. All of the elect were saved by that blood. There was not a single drop wasted. At the same time, there's not a single tear that we cry that does not have a purpose in God's plan in heaven. And he even promises at the very end, he will do what? He will wipe away every single tear. He who goes out weeping, bearing the seeds for sowing, shall come home with shouts of joy, bringing his sheaves with him. We're going to show up before the Lord saying, Lord, I have nothing. And the Lord's going to reveal to us a work that he was doing in and through us that is beautiful to behold. Our minds can't conceive of it. I don't even know what it could be, Lord. But I trust in your word here that when I come home, I will be bearing a harvest that you are the one who brought. And it will be beautiful. Let's pray. Father, our past bids us to treat the measure of the future. Lord, there's dry places and there's potential rivers that might flow, but we don't see them all the time, Lord. It's hard soil. It's good seed, absolutely. It's your word. It's walking in you. But Lord God, it is hard to see any harvest. And so, Father, as we journey, we realize that we're pilgrims who need a Savior who walks with us. And so, too, were the pilgrims realizing that the Lord God had worked behind them and was working with them now and was working eternally for them. And this is all because of you and your power and in your truth. And so we just depart, Lord, with this prayer on our hearts and minds from Galatians. Let us not grow weary of doing good, for in due season we will reap if we will not give up. So then, as we have opportunity, let us do good to everyone, and especially to those who are in the house of faith. In Jesus' name, amen.
A reminder that after this particular hymn, we'll be seated. Hear the next part. The solid rock. I was singing this last night. I thought, what a wonderful song to sing of your faith in the Lord and as a witness to those who don't know the Lord. It's all here. My hope is built on nothing less than Jesus' blood and righteousness. I dare not trust the sweetest frame, but wholly lean on Jesus' name, on Christ the solid rock. Stand together as we sing.
Hello, everyone. I am here to talk to you about this flyer. So if you look in your bulletin, you will find this piece of paper that's kind of reddish color. When I was, my name is Nadia, if you know, some of you don't know me. I am serving on the missions committee at our church. And this summer we were at Military Avenue Vacation Bible School. And I met this wonderful, lovely lady who was 80 years old from a different EPC church. Her name was Emily. She was helping us with crafts. And when I was introducing myself to her, she eagerly asked me, "So, are you from a mission-minded church too, Nadia?" And I said, nobody has ever asked me that, but I looked at her and I said, "Yes, actually, yes. Our church has been sending groups of missionaries to different parts of the world, parts of the country. We support a lot of missionaries, pray for them every Sunday. I am actually a product of a mission trip of this church. Ron and Jeannie DeHaas went 30 years ago to Russia and met me, and I'm standing here talking to you about a mission trip. Here we go. This one actually is an opportunity for our teens. So I'm actually talking to you, Jordan, Bryn, Matthew, Logan, Ty, Joel, Tanya. Anybody else I'm missing who is 13 to 19? I'm sorry if you feel you're 13 to 19. This is not for you. You actually have to have a birth certificate that proves you're 13 to 19 years old. If you feel that way and you're not actually physically that age, I have news for you too. You can participate. But we are partnering with an organization called Leader Treks. They are the same organization that provides materials for Pray For Me campaign that our church is participating in. The partnership is that they are organizing the trip on site for us in Manchester, Kentucky. They are providing trained youth leaders that will teach you guys, 13 to 19 years old, how to be servants of the Lord, how to be disciples, how to be leaders, and they're going to do it through some worship time, devotion time, also through service projects. It's either landscaping or a construction project. You're also going to be doing VBS for the local kids, all of that organized by you with the leadership of the youth leaders. So you have to, this is one thing I have learned about America, you plan your calendar a year in advance. Nobody in the world does that. In my part of the world, you don't know what will happen next day, so you don't plan next summer in September. You guys do. So mark your calendars for June 9 to 15, 1 week, Sunday to Saturday, because I want to see you in that van leaving for Kentucky. If you are interested, come talk to me. My phone number is on this flyer, or you can catch me at church, Sunday school picnic, anywhere, you know who I am. Come talk to me to find out how to sign up, what it takes to reserve your spot. Spots are limited, so please act quickly. And we will be doing preparations throughout the year to prepare for this trip. You can invite your friends. If we have spots, we're willing to take them as well. Come talk to me about what it takes. Thank you.
Well, you can see we have some exciting things happening, and I'm going to remind you of two other things. One, we have three circles. Sign up. Please sign up today. This is the last day to sign up. Choose whether you want a taco salad or an Italian sub for lunch. Want to train you in how to share the gospel. And I hope to have as many people possible there so that we, as the missionaries of Christ, will have just one more tool in our toolkit to share Christ with others. And also, small groups have begun. You can sign up out in the narthex as well. So when you go out to the narthex, grab a pen because you got lots of things to sign up for, and it's just a really exciting time. Let's end with a benediction. Would you stand and receive just a blessing from the Lord as we go from this place? He who is the very surrounding mountains of Mount Zion, who has set its foundations secure and it will last forever, has done so through his Son, Jesus Christ, in the hearts of his people.
To him and him alone be praise for his graciousness unto sinners that he has made saints. Praise and glory to the name of Christ Jesus, who calls us his own and has made us his children forever. And hallelujah to the Spirit that journeys with us, making this journey a journey of shalom. To God be the glory now and forever. Amen?
Amen.
Amen. See you at the picnic.